Today, I want to talk about a scientist that studied gases by the name of Joseph Gay-Lussac, and he's a French chemist or physicist. There's a lot of overlap there, and he's best known in chemistry kind of fields for a number of different things. But Gay-Lussac's law is one of the gas laws, and it studies pressure and temperature. So Joseph Gay-Lussac was around the same time that Jacques Charles was. And like Charles, Gay-Lussac was also a balloonist, and he had a lot of ballooning adventures. Hot air balloons were kind of the big cool technology of the day. And so they'd kind of race around and study gases based on different altitudes and look at different characteristics of gases and change different things using that technology. So, kind of a cool thing. Joseph Gay-Lussac is also well known for discovering the element boron. He actually isolated it from boric acid. So boron is B there on the periodic table, atomic number 5. And he also is known for some analytical chemistry that he did. He created some glassware. He's credited with creating things like a burette, which are used for titrations, and some other volumetric type glassware that was used to increase the precision of experiments in the day. So he had his hands in a lot of different chemical pies, if you will. And but I want to focus this video on his law, on the gas law. So what he found is that there's a direct relationship between the pressure of a gas and its temperature, which I think is pretty intuitive. And actually most of the gas laws feel pretty intuitive. But you know, when they were studying gases in the late 1600s, if you're talking Boyle's law, and then into the 1700s, if we're talking Charles' law and Gay-Lussac's law and Avogadro's law, these people were pioneers of the day, and what's intuitive to us now is only intuitive because it's been around for so long. Our understanding of these things came from these pioneers. And so a lot of these feel kind of simplistic, which is a good thing. It shows how far we've come, I think. So pressure and temperature are directly proportional. What we mean by that is if I was to increase the temperature of a gas, so if I increase the temperature below some sort of container that contains a gas, then the pressure is going to increase as well. So with a direct relationship, if one variable goes up, the other one goes up as well. And there's a couple things that we have to keep constant in order for this relationship to be true. This would be at a constant volume and a constant number of moles. So we'll call those V and N, kind of leading into our discussions about PV equals nRT and the ideal gas law in a later video. So if I have a constant volume and I'm not changing how many gas particles I have, if I increase the temperature, I increase the pressure. And that makes sense because pressure for gases comes from the gas particles striking the sides of the container. So anything that I do to increase the number of collisions with the sides of the container is going to cause the pressure to go up. And we could see because of kinetic molecular theory, when I increase the temperature, then I increase the speed and motion of particles. And gas particles are moving around in straight lines. So if we kind of picture a, let's look at a flask here of gas. And we'll put a stopper in it so the gas doesn't escape. That's pretty good. There's my stopper. Okay. If I have gas particles in here and they're kind of hanging out and meandering around, if I was to look at these kind of in my atomic microscope, there's a lot of space between them and they're moving around in straight line motions. And they're going to keep moving around in straight line motions until they collide with something else. It's unlikely they're going to collide with each other. They're so teeny tiny and there's a lot of space between them. It's much more likely they're going to collide with the sides of the wall. And anything, again, that increases the collisions with the side of the wall of a container is going to increase the pressure. So the pressure buildup from a gas causes is caused by the particles kind of maneuvering around there and banging into the walls. Okay, so I'm not changing the number of particles. I'm not changing the volume of my container here. But if I increase the temperature, then these things are going to move around more, which increases the pressure, and vice versa. That's how it works in a direct relationship or direct proportionality. If I was to decrease the temperature, then that would decrease the pressure. And that makes sense too, because if we think about kinetic molecular theory, You decrease the temperature, that slows everything down, fewer collisions, then the pressure of the entire kind of system is going to go down. Okay, so with that direct proportionality then, if I have an initial pressure and an initial temperature, when I take the ratio of those, it's going to give me some number. And if I was to change the temperature, that would give me a new pressure, but the ratio would still be equal to the same thing. So Gay-Lussac's law is often written as P1 over T1 is equal to P2 over T2. And this is true with any direct proportionality. The ratio of the variables that are directly proportional to each other can be set equal. So I change up one, it changes the other. But because they're both equal to the same thing, we can set them equal to each other. So this is Gay-Lussac's law. Now we can apply this to, this is kind of a silly problem. How so unlike me in my videos to have a silly problem. We have a Tupperware container with an absolutely perfect seal. It's the most perfect Tupperware container you've ever had in your life, full of some sort of trapped air. So I just have a trapped Tupperware container full of air. It's at room temperature, which apparently I keep my apartment really warm these days, and it has a pressure of 1.11 atmospheres. So when the container is placed in the fridge, so I'm taking an empty container full of air and putting it in my fridge, which is at 8 degrees Celsius, what is the new pressure? Well, we can figure that out, this very useful problem, by solving Gay-Lussac's law. So let's remind ourselves what it is. And then now we're going to list out the variables that we have. So we're given an initial pressure, that's that 1.11 atmospheres. We're given an initial temperature, that's going to be my room temp at 26 degrees Celsius. I'm looking for some final pressure, that's what I'm solving for here. But I know that I've changed my temperature because I've put this in the fridge. So it's going to be my 8 degrees Celsius. So I've listed out my variables. With gas laws, recall that the pressure units doesn't really matter which pressure unit you use so long as you're consistent. This problem didn't ask for a particular pressure unit, so I'm just going to give an answer in atmospheres. But for temperature, we have to always convert to Kelvin. Always convert to Kelvin with gas law problems. So we're going to convert this guy to Kelvin, 273.15. But again, I'm rounding this to the ones place, so that gives me 299 Kelvin. This one has a tenths place, so when I add my 273.15, then that gives me 281.2 Kelvin. All right, now we can kind of plug and chug. So I like to rearrange my variables first and then plug things in from there. We're solving for P2. So P2 is going to be equal to P1 T2 over T1. So that's going to be equal to my 1.11 atmospheres times my T2, 281.2 Kelvin, divided by my T1, which is 299 Kelvin. Now, if I'm analyzing this to see what I'm expecting my answer to be when it spits out of my calculator, then units wise, it's going to give me a pressure in atmospheres, which is good. So my Kelvins will divide out. If I'm thinking significant figures, which I always am, then 3 sig figs, it looks like, is what I'm going to be limited to. And now I like to think about this in terms of what is the magnitude of my answer going to be relative to my initial value? How is that pressure going to change? So that way, if I get a weird number in my calculator, I know that maybe I made a math error along the way, or maybe fat fingered a button, because that happens to me quite often. Okay, so let's think about this. My temperature is going down, and this is a direct relationship. So I would expect my answer to be less than 1.11 atmospheres. And when I plug and chug through here and then round to my 3 sig figs, I end up with 1.04 atmospheres. So I have a pressure that's smaller, which is what I'm expecting because it goes down, and 3 sig figs because I'm limited by my 3 from both my pressure and my T initial. Now, if we kind of think about this in terms of my container, you probably experienced this with Tupperware or with containers that you put into the fridge, then the seal changes, right? When you are opening a container that's been in the fridge for a while. So think about that next time you're grabbing your leftovers. What did you do to the pressure inside with the gas there? How did that change? And then you can actually feel the results of Gay-Lussac's law in that way, which is kind of cool. All right. I think that's it for me. If you have any questions on this, don't hesitate to reach out. Otherwise, I'll talk to you again soon.